Okay, that's a good reminder, actually. I'll press that button. Okay, I think we have a quorum. I'll just make a couple of announcements before we get started. Thank you all for being here. We are 3 weeks away from the end of the semester, I think. So we're in the final stretch. We have one more speaker at the end of the semester. It's going to be on May 12th. And I'm really excited about this as a sort of a surprise speaker. Brian Christian is a popular science writer and a really great person, and he'll be talking about his new book on sort of algorithms and human values, and it's going to be a lot of fun. So we're really happy to have him join us. So keep an eye out for that announcement, and then we'll also be announcing the fall speaker series lineup in the next few months. So as you all know, these are pretty informal lecture series. During the talk, you can write to each other in the chat if you want to have some banter, but we'll take questions at the end, and you can at that point either raise your hand, or if you don't want to be on the recording, you can write a question into the chat, and I'll moderate it. I'll read it out loud to the speaker. And if you also don't want to be in the recording, you can just turn your camera off and your audio off. Without further ado, I'll introduce today's speaker. I'm really excited to have Carlos Gershenson here today. He is a total legend in the complex systems field, and has really been a pioneer in sort of bringing complex systems and into Mexico and starting this amazing research center. He's at UNAM and leads the self-organizing systems lab. And has led a bunch of really awesome complex systems conferences and events and research initiatives. So we're really lucky to have him here. And today he's going to be talking to us about guiding self-organization of cyber physical systems. So Carlos, I'll let you take it away.
Thank you very much, Juniper, for the invitation and for the introduction. It's a pleasure being here. I would prefer to be in person, but better virtually than not at all. And also, it's not so easy to get from Mexico City to Burlington. But anyway, hopefully in the near future. So there's a paper with the same title where you can see more details about what I'll speak. It's like a introductory paper, an overview paper. So there are many concepts that I will speak about, and I won't go into the details of many of the things I will mention briefly. So if you are interested, you can go to the paper, and there I discuss a bit more, and there are also references to it. And well, we first have to speak about complexity, but of course you are familiar with this concept. Complexity, it's all around us. And even when we say that complexity is increasing, we're only beginning to understand it, because as Heinz Pechels said it in the late 80s, computers are the telescopes of complexity. Simply, we didn't have the proper tools to observe and to study complexity before we had computers. And I mean, if you can have a huge blackboard, but if you don't have, I mean, it's not enough to consider hundreds or thousands of variables, even if it's just very simple systems. So computers allows us to study complexity, just like telescopes allows us to study macrocosms, microscopes allows us to study microcosms. So it's not that people weren't aware about the relevance of complexity, just that they were unable to observe it. So it's like trying to fight pandemics without microscopes. It would be very difficult, or with genetic sequencing. So, well, you might know that complexity comes from Latin plexus, which means intertwined. So we can infer that something complex is something difficult to separate. So why something might be difficult to separate? Because there are relevant interactions between their components. So what makes interactions relevant? Basically that there's certain causality between the components of the system, and therefore you cannot study the components in isolation in order to understand what will happen to the parts and to the system itself. So suppose you have a friend from childhood, Bob, and you know everything about Bob. Let's say you have the laws of Bob somewhere, you already deduce them. So you know which kind of music he likes, which kind of food he likes, you know which kind of jokes he likes, you know which kind of films he likes, and so on. So you can say that you can predict what Bob will do. So let's assume that Bob enters University of Vermont and starts studying complexity and meets Mary, and they fall in love and they start going out. And suddenly we notice that our predictions about Bob's behavior start failing. He starts listening to country music and he swears less and he takes showers more often. And we cannot explain why this is going on. Maybe aliens abducted Bob and changed for someone else. But no, it's just that the interactions that he has with Mary change his behavior. It's not that it's entirely a new person. It's just that he's in a different context, and these interactions generate information that determine what will be the behavior of Bob. So let's assume that they graduate, they get married, they have a child, and then this baby will not only generate new interactions with Bob and Mary, that will generate new information that will limit our prediction of their behavior, but it will also change the nature of the interactions that they already had. So even if we updated our model or our laws that govern Bob to include Mary, once we include the child, we have to update those laws as well. So if we are trying to predict behavior and we see that it's limited just with three people, imagine trying to predict a whole city or a whole society. The big difference with complexity is that the interactions generate new information that it's not in initial or boundary conditions. So this limits predictability. In high school, we are taught that if you have initial conditions, boundary conditions, and laws that govern a system, then you can predict its future. And what we've seen with complexity is that this is not the case. We have limited prediction because of computational irreducibility, to speak in a bit more technical terms. Basically, there's no shortcut for the future. The information that interactions produce needs to be present in order to reach intermediate states that will lead us to the future. There's no shortcut, so that limits prediction. So traditional science tries to simplify and phenomena and isolate them in order to predict, but we see that for complex phenomena, this is insufficient. So we need to have new tools for this. And in the last three decades, many people in the community have been dedicating themselves to developing these tools precisely to understand complexity. And of course, it's tempting just to take the easy road, but that doesn't mean that it's the right one. A few years ago, with several colleagues, we developed this complexity explained. You can access it. And let's say there we explain for the broad audience what complexity is and different concepts related to it. So speaking about self-organization, there are many examples, but let's say we can have like this example of a white blood cell taking a bacterium. The brown cells are blood red cells. Let's say we can say that it's just a bunch of molecules, but then we can also say that there's life there and that the bacterium is running away from the white blood cell. And it doesn't mean that one description is better than the other. It means that one description might be more appropriate in some contexts than the others. But if we want to understand life, it's not sufficient to go to the lowest level and describe only that and let's say, as reductionists have tried to do and have failed miserably, trying to reconstruct all other levels based on the lowest level, which they even have defined properly. So, and say, I guess we should stop attacking reductionists because I think they had their chances and they failed already. But anyway, so self-organization. I mean, we're going to speak about guided self-organization. So there are also several definitions, but in general terms, we can say that a system can be usefully described as self-organizing if its components generate patterns or behaviors at the macro scale through their interactions. So let's say one important aspect is that you need two scales of description, the component and the system, and then the interactions will produce properties at the global scale that are not present in the individuals. And of course, flocks of birds are classical examples of self-organizing systems, swarms, schools of bees, crowds, but there are also examples of self-organization in every discipline. But then, if we speak about guided self-organization, it can seem contradictory because it's like herding cats, because let's say the components of a self-organizing system have like their own goals and aims, and then we're trying to impose or guide that behavior. So, I mean, I guess an analogy is trying to keep teenagers out of drugs. So you cannot tell them what to do, but you can try to bound their behavior, and then within those boundaries, then they will do whatever they want or what, whatever their rules guide them to. So that's one way of seeing guided self-organization. And one example is from the lab of Radhika and Akpal in Harvard, where they have these kilobots, which are tiny, very simple robots, and through local interactions, they can generate global patterns. So that's one example of guided self-organization. So we can say that guided self-organization is a way of designing the interactions of a self-organizing system so that these interactions lead the components and the system to a desired state or a desired function. So the question is, okay, how to do it? In order to do it, let's say there are several methodologies which have been proposed. During my PhD, I proposed one, but there are several others. But there's no like single recipe that says, okay, you just follow these steps and then you will end up with a nice self-organizing system that will solve any problem that you might have. But different concepts are useful, and that's what we'll see right now. So adaptation can be generally seen as response to change. This useful, well, I would say necessary to solve non-stationary problems. So traditionally, let's say in operations research or optimization, meta-heuristics, you have a problem and then you try to optimize it. And once you find a solution or a sufficiently good solution, you're done. So if you are trying to calculate, I don't know, the weights for a bridge so that it doesn't fall, let's say gravity doesn't change. So you just need to leave some margin for earthquakes and winds and hurricanes and so on. But let's say you don't need to adapt because the conditions don't change. But if you have a problem where the conditions are such that, let's say the problem is changing, like urban traffic or let's say social systems, then we call this non-stationary problem. So then your solution has to adapt as fast as the problem changes in order not to be to become obsolete. And also we could say that learning is adaptation at a relatively fast time scale. Development morphogenesis is adaptation at the time scale of one lifetime, and evolution is adaptation at the time scales of several generations. And we can have internal social and environmental adaptation. So there are different types of adaptation, but in order to face complexities, since let's say when you have complexity, you have interactions, and these interactions generate information. And this information probably will change your problem. So you will have to deal sooner or later with non-stationary problems. So adaptation is desirable for dealing with complexity. And robustness, it's complementary to adaptation. I like Andreas Wagner's definition. A system is robust if it continues to function in face of perturbations. And let's say there's lots of work on how to make systems robust. So let's say the difference between adaptation and robustness is that let's assume there's a perturbation, and if your system is robust, the perturbation does not affect the system. And with adaptation, let's say there's a perturbation and then the system changes to respond to the perturbation. So they're complementary in the sense that in, let's say, in some cases you want adaptation if the conditions change, but you also want robustness so that your system doesn't break down while it's adapting. So of course, it's a balance, because if you have too much robustness, then your system cannot adapt. And if you have too much adaptability, your system becomes fragile. And recently, there's a third related concept, which is antifragility, which might be a bit counterintuitive, but it's basically occurs when perturbations benefit a system. So one example is from a Mexican market. So we have water's made from fruits, and then the fruit goes down, and then you have to shake it so that it's tasty. Otherwise, it doesn't taste good. So it's something that you need to perturb in order to have a proper function. And there are other examples of antifragility, like the immune system. Also, it's known that neural networks, for example, Hopfield networks, classify better if there's some noise in them. So let's say it's relatively new, but it's an interesting concept. It's not always useful, but for example, just to relate it with a general concept from complexity, there's this idea from the 90s from Chris Langton and Stuart Kaufman that life is at the edge of chaos. And we have made some studies with random Boolean networks, which is a very abstract model of genetic regulatory networks that were proposed by Kaufman in 69. And let's say there was already some evidence that real genetic regulatory networks are on the ordered side of the phase transition between order and chaos, or on the phase transition. And we measured antifragility. Well, first we proposed a measure of antifragility, then we measured antifragility of random Boolean networks and of real genetic regulatory networks. And we see that rather than critical, they're antifragile. And how antifragile depends on how much noise there is in their environment. So basically, the antifragility allows systems to exploit the noise that they will face in order to go closer to criticality. Because if you are precisely critical and then there's noise in the environment, then you become chaotic. So let's say it's some recent results we've got. So mediators, you can see it as something that arbitrates between elements. So basically it regulates interactions, tries to minimize negative interactions, promote positive interactions, and also to maximize cooperation and synergy. And so we can call those positive interactions, and negative interactions would be friction and interference. So for example, traffic rules, we agree on which side of the street we will drive, and that minimizes the conflict each time two vehicles encounter each other. Then let's say there's no conflict because they just take their left or the right. Or money can also be seen as a mediator, because you don't need to barter and to agree that you will have something that someone else has to offer. So with money, let's say we have a mediator, and then we just have exchanges of goods and services, and everyone agrees on that. So mediator is a concept that can allow us to regulate the interactions of a self-organizing system in order to guide it to a desired goal. So one example of how the dynamics of complex systems can be counterintuitive is with the slower is faster effect. This was first described by Dirk Helding and Tomasz Wiczek about 20 years ago, a bit more studying crowd dynamics, but it's easy to observe in sports. So if you want to run a marathon, but start running at the speed of 100 meter dash, then you burn out very quickly and then you'll do a terrible time. If you go out walking, then you might finish, but you won't do the best time. So what's the best speed that you need to run in order to make the best time? It has to be a balance between burning out or arriving to without getting tired to the finish line. And of course, this depends on the distance and on the athlete and so on. First, it was studied in crowds. So in simulations of evacuation of rooms. So this is not a simulation. This several students that voluntarily participated, otherwise they would get flunked. And on the left hand side, let's say they are keeping calm, and on the right hand, they are panicking or simulating panic. And they're pushing each other. You can see that the width of the door changes. So if the door is broad enough, then it doesn't matter if they panic, the friction does not obstruct their exit. But in this precise case, it does. And if it's too narrow, even if they are going too slow, they will be there will be friction. So for this specific case, if they are not in a hurry, they have the equivalent of laminar flow. And if they are pushing each other or panicking, they have the equivalent of turbulent flow. And for example, in airplanes, when you evacuate, the door is broad enough so you can panic, and that's the best way of going out. So I hope you never need to evacuate a plane. So it turns out that sheep are also exhibiting the slower is faster effect. So on the left, they are not pushing each other so much, because on warm days, they're not as nervous as on colder days. And on the right hand, they are pushing each other more. So again, on the left, it's like laminar flow. On the right, it's like turbulent flow. So slower is faster, because if you don't try to push your way, or if everyone follows that rule, then everyone benefits. But of course, if everyone wants to go out as fast as possible, everyone loses from that. So it's also a bit of similar to tragedy of the commons. So and another concept that we've explored recently is that of heterogeneity. So we've seen that in many systems, as we see how they change in time, there are some components which change slower than others. So before, I don't know, 10 years ago, we didn't have enough data to study, let's say, what can be described as rank dynamics, so how ranks change in time. And when we started studying rank dynamics in languages, in sports, in economic systems, in natural systems, in social systems, we notice regular behavior, basically that the lowest ranked elements, the most important elements, change slower than the least important elements. So our hypothesis has been that this gives the system, a heterogeneous system, a balance between robustness and adaptability. So as I mentioned already, from this idea of the edge of chaos, criticality, or let's say so-called complex behavior, is found in the phase transition between order and chaos, but it's like very tiny region of the possible state space of any system. So let's say one might wonder how easy evolution might find this. And there are some work that show that indeed you can find it, this region through an evolutionary process. But what we are finding is that if you have heterogeneity, temporal heterogeneity and structural heterogeneity, it's much easier to exhibit complex critical-like behavior. And we're using this for search algorithms. So if you have search like genetic algorithm, then you just put heterogeneity. Basically, you mutate faster the worst individuals, and you mutate slower the best individuals. So it's a bit like elitism, but let's say it improves search independently of the problem domain. So if you use heterogeneity, in principle, you can find complex behavior with less fine tuning, because something that we are working with now, it's again with random Moolah networks, is that the properties of complex dynamics that you usually find in the phase transition, when you introduce structural heterogeneity and temporal heterogeneity, this region expands. So it's like, instead of having just the phase transition, then you have, let's say, a broader region of the parameter space where you have complex dynamics, which is precisely this balance between robustness and adaptability. The slower elements, which change which are more important, makes sense that they will change slower if they are relevant, because otherwise the function of the system is preserved. Those are robust. And then the least important elements, they are changing faster, and that makes the system adaptive. So that's a way of finding this balance in a much easier way. But of course, our models in the 90s, they are homogeneous because they're simpler to describe and implement. Okay, every element is the same. But now we are understanding and observing and having enough data to say, hey, in nature, most systems are heterogeneous, and this heterogeneity actually is a bonus. So we can exploit this heterogeneity also when we build artificial systems. So there are different approaches that can help us guide self-organization of cyber-physical systems. Of course, the first one is cybernetics. Let's say, probably you know a bit about the history of cybernetics. I tend to call it the grandmother of complexity. And one of its contributions is the classification of control mechanisms. So you can have feedback control, which is type of active control. Basically, you have perturbation, and then you have sensors, and that which you are trying to control, you perceive how it changes, and then there's a feedback to the controller, and the controller tries to reduce the effect of the perturbation on the control. With feedforward control, well, feedback can be positive feedback, negative feedback. Positive feedback amplifies the perturbation, negative feedback tries to eliminate the effect of the perturbation. With feedforward, before the perturbation affects the variables of the system that you're trying to control, you can say that there's some anticipation, and then there's an intervention, and this is useful because probably the perturbation might damage or change the functionality of the system. So if you can predict that or anticipate that, it's desirable. But we know from complexity that predictability is limited. So in many cases, you only know that a perturbation is coming and how it will affect the system only after it happened. So that's why, let's say, we cannot just predict everything, we need adaptation. And type of passive controller is buffering, which gives us robustness. Basically, there's a perturbation, and thanks to buffering, let's say the perturbation does not affect as much that which we are trying to control. So you can see that it's very similar to the concept that we're mentioning. Feedback control is similar to adaptation. Feedforward, it's similar to anticipation, that I didn't speak much about it, and buffering similar to robustness. So another useful concept is the law of recursive variety, which was described by Ross Ashby. So it basically states that the controller needs to have at least the same variety as that which it's trying to control. And variety can be understood simply as the number of states that a system can have. And of course, if we want to distinguish, I don't know, build a robot to solve 10 times of different assembly tasks, then it needs to have at least the variety to distinguish when to make different types of assembly. If you don't have that variety, then you don't know how to solve it. But it's almost tautological law, but our organizations are trying to control many things without fulfilling this law. So we have an educational system whose variety is lower than that which they're trying to control, namely the students. We have governments that have lower variety than the societies they're trying to control, and so on. So of course, that leads to the failure of these control systems. And of course, there are different ways. Okay, how can we fulfill the law of requisite variety? One is reducing the variety of the control, another is increasing the variety of the controller. And general systems theory, of course, anything can be described as systems. So it has, let's say, its history in parallel to cybernetics. And I mean, computer simulations, I already mentioned that we need is to understand, to study complexity. So this simulation of the game of life, you might have heard about these cellular automata. So we have some spaceships. So basically you have a grid, and in the grid, the cells can take values 0 or 1, and there are very simple rules. Each cell is updated according only to its neighbors, but then you have some structures which emerge, which move through space like these spaceships, and then they collide and then they annihilate each other. But there's some other structures, some guns which are shooting these spaceships, and then there's some circuitry that it's computing something, and then we'll see what it's computing. Well, actually, in the game of life, you can compute any computable function. How to program is a different thing, but if you can build a universal Turing machine, then you should be able to build the game of life itself, like in this simulation. But then try to imagine doing this on paper or on a blackboard. Hopeless. So let's say to study complex systems, we need computer simulations. And many disciplines are doing this in biology, sociology, and so on. I mean, it's becoming easier to program, so it's not a problem. Maybe generational gap, but each time we see more computational models in all disciplines. Well, also agent-based modeling has become popular in the last 3 decades. And it's much more natural to describe several phenomena in terms of agents instead of differential equations. Of course, say there's some equivalence, but on the one hand, people without a strong mathematical background can understand and can program agent-based models much easier than with differential equations, and then they're easier to translate to natural language, and also to translate natural language into agent-based models. So let's say it's a very popular approach. Network science has exploded in the last couple of decades. They're becoming like one of the most used approaches for studying complex systems, because naturally you can describe nodes as elements and their interactions as links between them. So we know from several examples that depending on the topology of the network, the functionality can change drastically. So you can have the same elements, but depending on how they are interacting, you have different properties or different functionality of the system. So this is already well known. And it should be sufficient to tell us that we need to know that it's not enough to know the properties of the elements, because it depends on how they're interacting as well. What will be the property of the system, the properties of the system. Another approach that's stemming from artificial life, it's known as living technology, which is simply technology which exhibits properties of living systems, so that it's adapting, that it learns, that it's robust. So it's if we understand these properties in natural systems, it makes sense to apply them in our artificial system. So this is known as the synthetic method. And let's say the third part of the talk, I will mention a few case studies that we've worked on. So I don't think that you have these scenes in Burlington often. I don't know, maybe in the queue for the ice cream, maybe. So this is the metro a few years ago, rush hour section for ladies, elderly, and children. And well, at the time where you need the system to be most efficient, it just collapses because people cannot get in, they cannot get out, doors cannot close, the train cannot leave the station. And if you want to enter, you have to do it through the window. So let's say many people tried to improve this successfully, and it's like, okay, how do you change behavior? Because it might be that I don't want to push, but if I don't push, I don't get inside the train. So everyone starts pushing. So it's a bit like in the example of the slower is faster effect, where people are evacuating a room and then they're starting pushing. And then by being selfish, the performance of the system decreases. So let me first show you how it works now and then what we did. So this is the same station and the ladies section. So people's queue, and these queues go out of the platform and they go up the stairs. And you can see that it's the same passengers that were pushing each other. It's not that we imported German or Japanese passengers that supposedly are more orderly than we are, and then everything worked. It's the same people, but basically we changed their interactions. I mean, we couldn't change the components of the system. We had to change their interactions. So what we did was to put, well, only to put signalization in the platform telling people where the doors would stand on each train. And we didn't know that people would queue. We were just hoping that they would leave some space so that people would go out and then they would push their way in. But let's say this information was enough to mediate between the interactions of passengers and change their behavior, because it's not necessary anymore to push each other. But before, if you don't have this information, you don't know where the doors will stop, then you have a homogeneous occupation of the platform. So because you don't know where you should stand, and then people just stand everywhere. And then when the train finally arrives and stops, there's no space so that you can move and let people out easily. There's only a few space, because even if you are next to the door, you try to move in one direction, but then there's people in the other direction and they try to get in. So they're pushing you in the other direction. So let's say that's a problem. So on the one hand, it allows the possibility of passengers to exit without friction. And on the other hand, for passengers waiting to board, it changes the rules, because it becomes the first ones to arrive are the first to get in. So it reduces the temptation of, even when the train is fully packed, to get in, because you don't know when the next train is coming. Here, you know that if you don't fit in the train, you will get in the next train. So this has changed the behavior. And this has been adopted in other stations without the signalization, because of course people understand that following these rules is beneficial for everyone. So if someone breaks the rules, the same passenger starts demanding other passengers not to free ride and to queue. So this is a viral video on another station about a year after these measures start being implemented in transfer stations. Again, in the rush hour, so you can see that the station is fully packed. There's not much space, but the organization is different from the first video. I mean, now you'll see that people are able to go out, not only of the train, but of the station without much friction. So of course we couldn't predict that, okay, we will install these stickers on the platform and then everything will change for the better. Let's say we did some simulations of crowd dynamics and let's say explore different options in simulations. And then with help of an industrial designer, we explored how would be the best option to install the signals, which material and so on. But fortunately, it had this positive effect, and it's still working 5 years after we implemented it. And it also prompted people to say, well, couldn't we do something like this for other systems where we cannot change the components? So, for example, okay, we cannot change the teachers, but maybe we can change their interactions so that the educational system will improve. We cannot change business people, but maybe we can change the interactions so that the economy will improve. We cannot change politicians, but maybe we can change the interactions so that they're not so corrupt. And of course, this is the idea of guided self-organization, how to regulate the interactions of a system so that the system performs in a desired way. Another example it has to do with self-organizing traffic lights. Before presenting it, let's say, just saying that if you improve traffic, probably it will induce more demand and it can be counterproductive. So let's say if some city wants to improve traffic lights, they should also try to reduce the number of vehicles on the streets and improve public transportation and cycling infrastructure. Okay, for that disclaimer. So there's some very abstract simulations of a city, same densities. On the left, you have traditional traffic light coordination. On the right, self-organizing coordination. And on the left, you have gridlock. On the right, you have maximum flow because every intersection is being used constantly. So basically, it's using sensor information. The idea is to give preference to the street with highest demand. And what happens is that if you have few demand, the vehicles will wait for a longer time than if there's a high demand. If there's a high demand, well, first of all, if there's a low demand, there's a probability that platoons will form. And then when platoons are of a certain size, they will trigger a green light before reaching the intersections. They don't have to wait unless there's another platoon crossing the intersection. So these simple rules generate emergent green waves. And it's adaptive because you are not trying to predict when vehicles will arrive at the intersection. It's just the same traffic flow is controlling the traffic lights, and traffic light is controlling the traffic flow at multiple scales. And with a PhD student, we implemented this in another simulation, a bit more realistic, and also compare it with autonomous vehicles. So we saw that if you have to choose between autonomous vehicles and self-organizing traffic lights, it's more beneficial to have self-organizing traffic lights with human drivers, because you can have autonomous cars, but if the intersections are not coordinated, then they will have to stop in vain. And of course, if you have and autonomous cars and self-organizing traffic lights, it's even better. But if you had to choose between one, it's better self-organizing traffic lights, and the cost probably is much lower. And with colleagues from ELTE in Budapest, in the group of Tamás Vicsek, we use similar approach to coordinate quadcopter traffic. So in three dimensions, it's a bit easier because if there's some conflict, some friction, then you just exploit the third dimension and one UAV can go above the other. And the last case study has to do again with public transport. So there's what we call the equal headway instability problem, also known as the bus bunching problem. So I don't know whether you have this in Burlington, but if you go to larger cities, you might wait for the bus or for the train or for a tram, and you wait, and then suddenly there are like four vehicles coming one after the next. And the Russian explanation is that they were playing domino and then they started working. But what we show, what we demonstrated with computer simulations is that actually that's the natural tendency of public transportation systems. Basically, that theory tells us that it's optimal to keep intervals, also known as headways, between vehicles as equal. So every train or every bus arrives every 5 or 10 minutes, and that will minimize the waiting times of stations. And what we show is that this configuration is unstable, basically because there's a positive feedback. If there's a delay, so for example, vehicle C, on the top of the diagram, will find lots of passengers for whatever reason at the station, and then that will delay him. It will increase its headway with vehicle B, reduce its headway with vehicle D. Therefore, at the next station, there will be more passengers and it will get further delayed and so on. And then you have all the vehicles bunching. And even if you allow for passing of vehicles, like with buses, let's say they still are clumped. So we propose a self-organizing algorithm to regulate intervals between vehicles. So in another very abstract simulation, you try to keep regular intervals, but then these become unstable and you end up with, let's say, the bunched up vehicles and then passengers waiting much more time. So here, the self-organization is inspired by ant colony communication. So we use anti-pheromones to basically tell neighboring vehicles how far they are, how separated they are from their neighbors. And you can achieve supraoptimal performance. How come supraoptimal? That seems like an oxymoron. Well, because the theory was wrong. It assumes that if you have equal headways, then passenger waiting time at station will be minimized. That is true, but then the theory assumes that then the total travel time is independent of the headways, and it isn't. So in order to keep equal headways, you basically need to keep either idling vehicles so that every vehicle waits the same time at the same station. You could have different waiting times for different stations, but every vehicle needs to wait the same time at different station, at the same station. And of course, the demand changes constantly. Each time a train or a bus arrives at a different station, there's a different number of passengers waiting at the station and in the vehicle as well. So the problem is non-stationary, it's changing constantly. And what happens with the self-organizing controller is that indeed people wait for longer. So let's say it doesn't violate that part of the theory. But then because of the slower is faster effect, once you board the train, you will reach your destination faster because you don't have to idle. So the algorithm, you can imagine that you have vehicles and they're joined by springs. And then if one vehicle gets too far from others, then these strings will pull it back. And if they get too close, the springs will pull them apart. And if there's high demand at the station, that serves as a magnet that tries to grab the vehicle so that they don't leave the station without giving service to the passengers, unless it's full, of course. So in this simulation that we did with another PhD student, Gustavo Carreon, on the top, this time distance diagram. So the black dots represent positions of trains along the simulated first line of the Mexico City Metro. So each time they take a little step, it means that they stopped at the station, and then there's an interruption here at one of the central stations, and you see that all the trains bunch up and then they never recover. And here with the self-organizing controller, there's the same interruption like 10 or 15 minutes. And since the vehicles try to keep equal distance between their neighbors, you can see that the vehicles that are ahead of the interruptions start slowing down, so that the intervals will not be too big. And this allows the system to adapt even before the system reestablishes the service. And once this occurs, let's say in 15 minutes or so, it's as it used to be. So finally, let's say I mentioned lots of different concepts, and I don't mean to say that self-organization is the best solution always. So it's useful to say, okay, when is it useful and when other approaches might be more appropriate. So centralized control is useful when you have low complexity and causality goes from, let's say, from a central entity or from a higher entity to the lower regions, to the lower scale. And distributed control, it's, let's say, without considering coordination, because we could say that self-organization is a type of distributed control, but not vice versa. So in general, distributed control, when you have bottom-up causality, basically what the components do will determine what the system do, but you also are restricted to low complexity and also to homogeneous components, because let's say in order to integrate solutions, it's difficult when you have heterogeneity. And self-organizing control, it's useful when you have multi-scale causality. So for example, in societies, individuals determine social norms, but then the social norms determine individual behaviors. So if you want to change one of them, either the individual behavior or the social norm, it's a chicken and egg problem. And self-organization offers one way of trying to solve this. It doesn't mean that if you do, you will solve it, because let's say it's just a potential for solution. It doesn't mean that all self-organizing solutions will be successful. But at least it has chances. If you take a centralized solution, it's probably it will fail. It also allows us to deal with high complexity and with homogeneous or heterogeneous systems. And now I mentioned active controller and passive controllers. So the active control has to do more with adaptation and antifragility, and also agents are more amenable to be used to describe active control because it deals with functional aspects. And passive control has to do more with robustness and heterogeneity, and networks are more natural to design passive controllers because they deal with structural aspects. And of course, these are not exclusive. In many cases, you can have agents on networks or combine adaptation and robustness. And let's say, because in many cases, you are interested not only in functional or structural aspects, but in both of them. So finally, I just invite you to subscribe to Complexity Digest, a newsletter that was started in 1999 by Dean LeBaron and Gottfried Meyer, and we've been editing it at UNAM already for more than 10 years. So you can receive the latest news and papers from the complexity community or follow us on social networks. So I hope there's some time for questions.
Yes, thank you so much. And do follow Complexity Digest. They have the Twitter is very helpful. And if you would like, please join me in unmuting yourself and thanking the speaker. Lovely. We have some time for questions, so you can raise your hand or unmute yourself and jump in. Start a little queue. Laurent.
This isn't a question for me, but Thomas in the chat asked earlier, what do you think are the big successes in description and prediction from agent-based modeling, or really any type of complex systems modeling? What did we do well?
Yeah. Well, I think we have done several things well, and in some cases, let's say, not necessarily it has been recognized. So I would argue that computational social science comes from the complex systems community. I mean, but what computational social science is doing, basically it's making the so-called soft sciences harder, because before we had computer simulations, agent-based modeling, and so on, different theories in sociology and psychology, let's say, they were reduced to rhetoric. So you didn't have evidence. So for example, in history, you cannot replay the tape and say, okay, this was because of that. So you have a hypothesis, but then it's difficult to contrast that with experiments. And in sociology, you could, but it's very time-consuming to gather data from polls or from other sources. And in psychology, with experiments, it's also very time consuming and limited. So not only with computer simulations, but basically with big data and how it's become available. I mean, that the amount of information that our civilization has produced doubles every 2 years. It allows us to contrast different theories about how rumors are spreading, how, let's say, opinion formation and so on. So in Vermont, for example, the hedonometer is a good example of how you can study, let's say, social emotions in real time. And before, let's say, you could just speculate about whether there was such a thing. So I think that's very soon, well, even 20 years ago, people were speaking about biology, well, about evolution as evolutionary theory in a despective tone, because they say, well, yeah, it's a theory because you cannot prove it. And when people started doing evolution in vivo, like Richard Lenski, then they, let's say, they couldn't complain anymore. So let's say evolutionary theory, let's say now you can prove it in vivo, not only with simulations. And I think that the tools that are being developed soon will have the effect that the social sciences will be also, let's say, as hard as the more traditional sciences.
Lovely answer. Jeremiah, did you have a question? I think I remember that being in the chat. Or Olin, I think you both had questions.
Yes, so thank you very much for that talk, Carlos. My question is, were there any incentives at play in the train scenario beyond placing the stickers and encouraging people, like, you know, if you're organized, then you get on the train faster? Were there any other things, like, I don't know, ice cream or something?
No, I mean, when we first made the pilot study in one of the stations, there were volunteers and policemen like trying to guide people and explaining, because especially at rush hour, people would enter the platform and you didn't even see the stickers. So they were kind of cajoling people to follow the rules and to know that there was this new way of boarding the train. So that was also very useful. But it was not, let's say, anything else. Like, yeah, the system working was a reward on its own.
Alan, I think you had a question.
Yes, thank you. Hey, Carlos. Thanks for the talk. I'm just curious about how can we prevent these self-organizing systems to go back from to the original state, or they can even evolve to another state which is not convenient to. Yes. So how can we manage that?
Yeah, I mean that's a good question, because it's limited our knowledge about the world, not only because we are limited ourselves, but because, let's say, the world is constantly unfolding into new situations. So even if we have a system functioning and it has worked well for thousands of years, doesn't mean that it won't reach a new situation where it will break. So let's say we don't have like a foolproof way of ensuring that nothing wrong will happen, but in order to minimize the impact of such situations or to prevent them, let's say if our systems are adapting and they are robust, then it might encounter new situations that it has never encountered, but the system will keep on functioning and might adapt to the new situations. So one of the main ideas of guided self-organization is that you don't have to predict all the possible situations that a system will encounter, but you build a system robust enough and adaptable enough so that no matter how the system is changing, how the problem is non-stationary, the system will adapt through the interactions of its components. So that's like the guiding principle, but it doesn't ensure that it won't break down.
Lovely. I think we have time for maybe one more question, if anybody has a burning question they want to ask before we close out. I know we have class starting in a few minutes. All right. Oh, okay. Well, thank you so much. I know people are have some classes to get to in a few minutes. But it was so nice to have you here, and hopefully next time we can have you here in person. Yeah. That would be really lovely to have you visit the center. So join me one more time in thanking our speaker.
Thank you so much.
Thank you all. I'll see you in a few weeks at the next one. Bye.
Bye.